Please help me welcome the great partner in education in LA, Judy Baca.
Well, good afternoon. I'm happy to add my voice and, of course, the presence of my images in this space to this day. This is a site of public memory. The question is, what should we remember? What was a moment in 1968 in which we lost a great American leader? And the course of history was changed forever. But most importantly, what of that time should we hold? What should we carry with us? And what was so important to me in those moments with Max, who delivered to me the first day in the studio, and the moments with Paul and with Dolores, is what they chose to remember. And what Max said to me was, here is what my father was reading. And I set about reading all of the books that Bobby Kennedy was reading on his way to becoming our President of the United States, our hope for the presidency. And what he was doing was he was transforming himself. He was coming to the place of what enlightened leadership should look like. And so I wanted to just say a couple of things about this particular site of public memory. I spent most of my life trying to figure out how to create public memory in physical places. And when I came to this place, the challenge was enormous. Not only because I knew the experience of Paul, and I thought if I could bring Paul to this space in the end, and that it would feel transformed, that we had done the job. We'd made a site of public memory that remembered what Bobby Kennedy stood for. So it was a worthy challenge. How should we remember RFK? How should we inspire generations of students and community groups who will use the space? What is the story that we should tell and remember? The wisdom of the committee that was the memorial committee was that the site of this school should be a tribute to Kennedy's beliefs and his life. So I began with looking at his own words. And of course, the famous statement that he made, and a reminder that it was done in Soweto at the time of apartheid, in which he was invited to speak. And he began in a way that was really charming and Bobby. He said, "I have the deepest interest and affection for a land settled by the Dutch in the mid-17th century, then taken over by the British, and at last independent, a land which the native inhabitants were at first subdued, but relations with whom remain a problem to this day. A land which defined itself on a hostile frontier, a land which has tamed rich natural resources through the energetic application of modern technology, a land which once imported slaves and now must struggle to wipe out the last traces of that former bondage." And then he smiled at his audience. He was talking about the United States of America and not about South Africa. So it is at that point that he gave the famous speech. Few, he stated, will have the greatness to bend history itself, but each of us can work to change a small portion of events, and the total of all these acts will be written the history of this generation. Each time a person stands for an ideal or acts to improve the lot of others or strikes out against injustice, he sends forth a tiny ripple of hope. So this was what I tried to imagine. What is a tiny ripple of hope? How does it affect us? And how do we make a piece that speaks to that moment? So if this is tiny ripples of hope, it is about hope, and on the opposite side is about compassion. When he finished his speech, the crowd cheered and lifted their hands toward this man, the visionary. This is memorialized in this particular piece. but instead the hands that are holding Kennedy up are hands from our own communities. There's Dolores' hands there. She can point out which ones they are if you get a chance to ask her. Paulo's hand is there. There are great writers, there are great poets, there are great artists, all of whom came to the studio so they could be placed in it. There's the leaders and civil rights who are in these pieces. And also, we have a memorial to the fact that Kennedy, at the eulogy for his brother, said, "Take him and cut him out in little stars, and he will make the face of heaven so divine that all the world will fall in love with night and pay no worship to the garish sun." He's quoting Shakespeare. Imagine a leadership today quoting Shakespeare. If the first mural speaks to hope, the second speaks to compassion. Incidentally, these are the antidotes for sociopathic behavior. We're very concerned about sociopathic behavior of young people. Hope and compassion. And seeing through others' eyes, the opposite side here, these two pieces kind of speaking to each other, a lotus blossom determines the composition of the mural, both formally and conceptually. I drew inspiration from Robert Kennedy's words describing the most significant issues facing our generation. This was my generation. The first is war. The second, lotus blossom, holds healthcare. The third, poverty. The next, intolerance. The next, education. And last, the environment. He was speaking to the students of the 60s at a time, at that time, of course, and all these issues, of course, today are still the issues that we must face. That is war, healthcare, poverty, intolerance, education, and the environment. Each petal represents one of these issues with possible antidotes to the problem. And you look into the issues of intolerance and poverty, and you'll find Paul and Dolores as antidotes to those particular points of view. They're depicted. You'll also see various other people who provided leadership. But important to note, we are on the edge of Koreatown. The lotus grows with its roots fastened to the mud, while its beautiful flowers reach out of the water to the sunlight. It's a pattern of growth, signifies the progress of the soul, from the primeval mud of materialism, mud of materialism, through the waters of experience, into the bright sunshine of enlightenment. The mud is likened to the roots of evil, namely greed, hatred, delusion, while the blossom stands for enlightenment. Thus, the blooming of these sun-loving flowers is a metaphor for the enlightened being who emerges undefiled despite living in the world of Maya. At the center of the blossom sit two enlightened men. Kennedy is depicted breaking the bread with Cesar Chavez on the 28th day, I believe it is, of the fast for life. Juan Romero, the busboy who cradled Kennedy after he was shot, is depicted to the left of Kennedy, as is Martin Luther King. In healthcare is a healing circle formed around a 100-year-old woman, modeled by members of my own family. My mother, Hortensia, my aunt, Rita, who are depicted in this, are with Lourdes, their madrina. In the poverty petal, Kennedy is on his famous poverty tour, where at the top he speaks to children, seeing through their eyes the plights in the inner city, reservations and rural farming fields and poverty. The foreground image is one of our homeless population, and I make a shout out here to Mark Ridley Thomas for pointing that out to us again, and it is in this work. In the intolerance petal, a million people march on the Primero de Mayo in Los Angeles, led by a young Dolores Huerta. Behind her is Charles Kim, the father of Koreatown, as people demand rights for immigrant workers in the city. our pedal on bad education to a young girl, crossing her fingers in the hope she will make it. Our antidote is a creative social justice education where children work to build gardens, to clean up our river, to participate in music and dance, and in the arts as you see here, and all the while to be citizens about which Robert F. Kennedy so eloquently spoke. So in conclusion, to my students who participated in this work, to the people at the Social and Public Art Resource Center, I owe a great gratitude because this work is never done alone. It's always done with a community of people. It takes all of us to make something. This took years to produce, and the great inspiration of the people who preceded me. This is a place of renewed hope. It is our hope that young people who come to this space will be inspired by tiny ripples of hope to complete their education and become active citizens who can see through others' eyes and continue the work for social justice here in Los Angeles, across our country, and worldwide. Thank you.